Good day. We are going to look at the types of devices, components of a microcomputer, and the functions of these devices. We are not going to look at all the devices in one lesson, so this lesson is called Part 1. The terms we are going to be learning: input, output, storage, I/O, which stands for input-output, doing both input and output, processing, CPU, which is our central processing unit, ALU, arithmetic logic unit, control unit, CU, hard copy, soft copy, RAM, random access memory, ROM, read-only memory, joystick, mouse, trackball, touchpad, keyboard, megahertz, gigahertz, motherboard, puck, stylus. Let's start. You may pause your video here and copy these terms. You will be assessed on them. Now, this is a basic computer. Four main components of a microcomputer. As you can see here, this is our CPU's holding the case the CPU is in. Also, your ROM is inside the case. It is called the system unit. This one is not a box. It is called the system unit. Also, the case. Keyboard, your internal memory, and a monitor. As you can see, a computer does not require a mouse to function. If you have your system unit with all the components inside, together with your keyboard, your internal memory, and your monitor, your computer will function. At your keyboard, the input takes place, the processing takes place in your system unit and internal memory, together with your CPU, central processing unit, and the output of your on your monitor. Input is the information given to the computer. Computer devices receives the data through input device. For example, a keyboard or a disk drive, the drive that you put maybe a CD or a DVD in. Processing is a series of instructions which the computer executes. Why? To achieve a specific result. Internal memory is used to temporarily save instructions and data while the computer is busy executing them. Where does this happen? In the CPU. The CPU, also the full term, central processing unit. Its speed is measured in either gigahertz or megahertz. Inside the CPU, we find two main components: the control unit, which controls everything inside the CPU, and the ALU. The ALU performs arithmetic, arithmetic, and logic, logic calculations. Arithmetic, mathematical calculations, and logic, logical questions. Yes, no, true, or false. Now, output is the information the computer generates as a result of its calculation. So it's the information. So you enter data, and during the processing stage, it is given structure, which is then output. Information. Data plus structure gives you information. Okay, so it's the information the computer generates as a result of its calculations. We get two types of output. Permanent, like a printout, it's called a hard copy, such as a printed page. Then temporary output, it's displayed on a monitor or it's maybe on a hard disk, or you can put it on an optical disk such as a DVD or a CD. That is called a soft copy. Also, if you watch it on a smartphone or a tablet, that's also a soft copy. What do you think a photo that you printed from your camera would be? Hard copy or soft copy? Yes, hard copy. What about a presentation like this lesson? Hard copy or soft copy? So we know the photo that is printed is a hard copy. What do you think about a presentation? Can you touch it? Can you give it to somebody? It is obviously a soft copy. If we open the system unit, inside the system unit we find all the wiring, the fans, the motherboard, the power supply. So basically everything is mounted onto the motherboard. This is a picture of a motherboard. Here you can see the place where the CPU is fitted. There's your ports. We will discuss them in a later lesson on I/O. There are more ports. Your RAM slots, where your RAM, your memory goes, there's your RAM slots where your memory goes in. And these are I/O slots for cards. It houses the CPU. This is where the CPU comes in. And it's the most important component of your computer, and it does basically all of the work. If you remove a CPU, your computer will not function anymore. We're looking at internal memory. If we go back, we said the internal memory is fitted in there, and it's also programmed on the motherboard. We have two types of internal memory. We have ROM and we have RAM. These are primary memory. The ROM, read-only memory. It's internal. All commands needed to start the computer. It is permanent, meaning you cannot change it. And it assists the bootstrap loader in what? To start the computer. Where with RAM, random access memory, so the space, the RAM, can be accessed at random. It's also internal since it's built into the computer, used when programs are loaded or run. When you open a program, it is loaded in RAM, where this one is pre-programmed. It is volatile. RAM is volatile, meaning that it's temporary. You need to save your information, because if the power fails, data that's not saved will be lost. So you can remove RAM, make your computer faster and put larger memory in, or to speed up the computer. So basically some aspects that surrounds RAM has to do with the speed of your computer. So this is an image of RAM. And it's primary and it's temporary. ROM, pre-programmed, helps to start the computer, permanent. You cannot remove this one or make it faster. And it helps to start the computer in relation with the bootstrap loader. External memory, outside of the computer. Storage or related memory outside the computer. A device used to store data or instructions permanently until a change occurs. External memory is also called secondary or auxiliary. If you think back, primary inside, so it's the computer is going to use this one first. Secondary outside, auxiliary. Here we can look at external hard disks, optical disks such as DVDs and CDs, USB flash disks, and your internal hard drive. The first input device we are going to look at is your keyboard. Primary computer input device. It's got a typewriter type keypad. You also have different layouts. Most or 90% of your keyboards have a numeric keypad on the right hand side. QWERTY keyboard is the British American layout. Its keys on in the middle row, Q W E R T Y, and this is the most commonly used one. A keyboard is used to enter data. Remember, I said you enter data. The CPU performs processing, which gives it structure, and then it becomes information. So we do not enter information, we enter data, which becomes information. For example, typing letters, entering data into a spreadsheet or a database, searching the web, writing emails, and playing games. That's all part of data that's entered. Once what you see on the computer, it's already received structure, which becomes useful information. We are going to look at input still, but a category below input pointing devices. It is used in a graphical user interface. You can add that term to your terms. That means the computer uses graphics for the user to be able to interact with it. When using a pointing device, we work with pictures. We are going to repeat this a lot while we are busy with pointing devices. We work with pictures, which are called icons, which we activate. Icons are options on the computer that you can choose. And once you use a pointing device to activate the icon, it means you've activated an option. Better than typing long commands with a keyboard. So if you are using icons, which is part of GUI, which is graphical user interface. GUI, graphical user interface, it's much better than typing long commands with a keyboard in a command line interface. Blinking item on the screen, the one that I'm using that's moving around, that is called your pointer, and it mostly looks like an arrow, as you can see there. You select an item by moving the pointer over it and clicking on it, therefore activating an option. Once the object is or the item is selected, you can move or manipulate it. Our first pointing device, still on input but pointing, a mouse. We get different types of mouse. All microcomputers, most of them today, has a mouse, that it comes out with a mouse. It is used to point or click on icons, again to activate options. You control and manipulate icons on the screen. When you click on an icon, your operation is, or a specific operation is, activated. We can move the mouse on a flat surface next to the computer, and that then specifies where the arrow goes. We have a left and a right mouse button on our mouse. There they are, and your scrolling wheel. We move objects by holding the left one in and then dragging it. We activate other options by using the right click, the right button. We have optical mouse, we have other types of mouse, we have wireless mice. This one connects using a USB interface. And we continue with a mouse. The older type mouses had a ball at the bottom, as you can see. This one is taken apart. Newer ones uses a weak laser light, and this is why it's called an optical mouse, also used to click and point. Trackball. It mostly looks like a mouse, but a little bit different. It's got a ball on the outside, where this mouse had the ball on the inside at the bottom, and just a part of the ball was sticking out. Here the ball is on the outside. Looks like an upside down mouse. Your fingers move the ball. You can also use your palm to move the ball. Once you move the ball, roll the ball, the pointer will move on the screen. You do not move a trackball like you would move a mouse. It stays mostly in one place on the desk. A puck, another pointing device, still forms part of input. It's a mouse-like device. A puck is a computer input device. It contains a contains glass or magnified glass with a crosshair. This allows the user to accurately trace objects. So this one is mostly used in computer-aided design, where you want to trace an object, but it's still a pointing device. Stylus. All of us knows a stylus. I used a clip art picture so that we don't brand using specific phones or tablets. It's a pen-like device. You use it to manipulate icons on a touch screen. So you cannot use a stylus on a CRT screen or a screen that is not touched enabled. A touchpad used on a laptop. We all know a touchpad. It also has two buttons, one for left click, one for right click, and this space you use your finger mostly to move the pointer. Advantage of a touchpad, you don't need to carry a mouse with you. It's got all the functions of a mouse, and it comes on laptops and notebooks. A touch screen. We are all familiar with a touch screen. It's a specialized visual display unit. The screen is sensitive to your touch. We get them in restaurants, at ATMs, and many other places. Your smartphone also has a touch screen where you touch the screen to activate the options. A joystick is our next input pointing device. It converts the 3D hand your hand movements into three-dimensional. It converts the physical actions into graphics on the screen. It has buttons for additional commands, you can see it. And we find it in gameplay and also training for pilot simulations, and as well, you also find it in an actual aeroplane. They also use a joystick. Some large earth-moving equipment also uses joysticks. Converts your hands movement into a 3D action. So, this is the introduction for part 2. Go to the video for part 2 and we will discuss the rest of our devices. Happy learning. Stay safe.